Macmillan Audio presents Bored and Brilliant by Manoush Zomorodi. Read for you by the author.
Introduction. The Case for Boredom. My son and the iPhone were born 3 weeks apart in June 2007. I'm more of a 2.0 kind of woman, so I didn't rush out to buy one, and anyway, I had more pressing things to tend to. My new baby was colicky and miserable. I spent hours pushing him around, trying to soothe him to sleep, which he would only do when his stroller was in motion. We probably wandered the equivalent of 10 to 15 miles a day. Our walks were also very quiet because my newborn required utter silence to snooze longer than 15 minutes at a time, so I couldn't talk on my flip phone or get coffee from the bodega or even just sit on a bench. The baby weight flew off, but I was the most bored I had ever been in my entire life. At first, I was angry, frustrated, and sad. It was the classic story of my generation. A woman goes from urban professional to cloistered mom in one shocking instant. Once upon a time, I was a foreign news producer, always dropping into emergency situations no matter where in the world they happened. If the Concorde crashed or the parliament in Belgrade was set on fire, I went. For 12 years, I worked in the fast-paced world of broadcast journalism. On my time off, I thought nothing of spending an entire Sunday on the couch to plow through the New York Times and the latest novel. When I became pregnant with my first child, I pictured me and my husband Josh, a fellow journalist and adventurer, putting the baby in a backpack or something as we traveled the world and were still amazing at our jobs. What a joke. I had no idea. After I had my son Kai, my ass got kicked so hard. I felt lonely and truly fatigued as never before. New York Times? The latest novel? Us Weekly was the most I could handle between back-to-back nursing sessions and unloading the dishwasher. After a few weeks of my stroller-pushing marathons, though, there was a shift. Not only did I get into a rhythm, but I also began to see things in my neighborhood that I had never noticed before. Ornamental cornices and gargoyles became familiar friends. I grew to be an expert in the blooming patterns of the neighborhood's landscaping. I even knew the cracks and bumps in the sidewalk by heart. I gave in to the discomfort of nonstop walking and started appreciating the fact that I had no destination. How many times when I was stuck in the office till all hours of the night would I have given anything to roam aimlessly? Most important, I came to understand what it means to have symbiosis with your child. Being completely in tune with this beautiful new human being I had created required slowing down to a pace that at first made me deeply uncomfortable, then completely transformed me. Indeed, he grew less and less colicky, and soon enough, those days of wandering that had soothed both of us ended. I went back to work, and if I thought life was busy before, I didn't know the meaning of the word. The next several years flew by in a flurry of personal and professional creativity and effort. I covered tech and business for Reuters and then New York's public radio station, WNYC. I wrote my first book, A Guide to Making Video for Nonprofits and Businesses, and welcomed my daughter, Soraya. Then in 2013, after 6 months of doing weekly news updates on technology, after suggesting WNYC cover more of the sector's burgeoning scene in New York, I was offered my dream job, hosting my own weekly radio show and podcast about the human side of technology. Running the show, which would eventually be called Note to Self, I was riding high on possibility. I had the chance to produce something meaningful and interesting about a subject essential to modern life for an intensely responsive group of listeners. This was the opportunity of a lifetime, with creative control and responsibility on a level that I had never experienced before. And if I screwed it up, might never again. At the start, I was firing on all cylinders. Surrounded by smart, insightful people, I found no shortage of fascinating stories to cover and received great feedback from the public. And then I hit a wall. Crashed, is more like it. This was different than writer's block, which in the past I'd experienced as a stuck place I needed to work through. This was blankness. There was just nothing. It was bad. Part of the problem was, of course, the pressure that came with the unbelievable opportunity before me. Wanting to do the best job possible can be crippling. But there was also something else going on. My mind felt tired, worn out. Why? Yes, I was juggling motherhood, marriage, and career in one of the most hectic cities in the world, but it was more than that. In order to analyze what was going on with me, I began observing my own behavior. What I found was, frankly, exhausting. As soon as I took a moment to reflect, I realized there wasn't a single waking moment in my life that I didn't find a way to fill. And my main accomplice was my phone. I had long ago traded in my old flip phone for a smartphone, and now it seemed like I spent every spare minute on it, whether waiting for the subway or in line for coffee or at my son's preschool for pickup. I was engaged in some kind of information call and response. I checked the weather, updated Twitter, responded to emails. When I flopped into bed at the end of an exhausting day, instead of turning out the lights, I chose to fire up Two Dots, a game I couldn't stop playing despite myself. I wasn't using my smartphone to connect. I was using it to escape. Scrolling through Twitter made my long commute disappear. Updating my calendar obsessively gave me the feeling of productivity. As my life ramped up, so had the pace and quantity of my technology consumption. My brain was always occupied, but my mind wasn't doing anything with all the information coming in. In trying to figure out when in the past my best ideas had come to me, I was reminded of my time with Kai. During those long, solitary, tech-free walks where I was cataloging the details of everything I saw around me, I also did an internal assessment of the professional skills I'd acquired over the previous 15 years. Like my meandering strolls, it wasn't a conscious accounting, but rather a winding mental trip through my career so far and how I might like to put my skills to work next. I let my mind go. It went to some dark and uncomfortable places, but it also went to some weird and wonderful ones. Looking back at that experience during this hectic period of my life, I saw a connection between a lack of stimulation, boredom, and a flourishing of creativity and drive. It was so clear to me because the cycle of technological innovation sped up at exactly the same time my life did too. Between the time my son was born and could walk, we saw mobile technology change the way people called a taxi, ordered food, found a date. Suddenly, very basic societal actions that had remained unchanged for decades were upended. And then, when the next operating system came out 6 months later, upended again. My life wasn't just pre-children and post-children. It was simultaneously pre-mobile phone, post-mobile phone. Both children and smartphones shifted me to the core. In light of all this, I asked myself, can my lack of ideas have to do with never being bored? The original Bored and Brilliant Project. There is no question that we are at an unprecedented point in history where our attention is in hot demand. With the advent of smartphones and tablets, mobile consumers now spend an average of 2 hours and 57 minutes each day on mobile devices and about 11 hours a day in front of a screen. Although we don't know if all this screen time will have longer-term harmful effects, we know technology is changing us, and it's unclear whether it's for the better. Parents fret about how to raise healthy and confident children in the digital age. If our children are constantly engaged with bits and bytes of information, what is happening to their ability to imagine, concentrate deeply, reflect on past experiences, decide how to apply those lessons to future goals, and figure out what they want for themselves, their relationships, and life? It isn't just parents who worry about the shift in how we use our brains in the tech age. The implications for business are significant as well. There is evidence that people could be better at their jobs if they weren't always plugged in. The Bank of England's chief economist said he fears that skills building, innovation, and entire economies could be at risk because, quote, fast thought could make for slow growth. And what does all this scrolling, processing, blue light, and more mean for our health? All you have to do is stay up hours past your bedtime, playing two dots, as I shamefully have, to know the answer. Sometimes it's relaxing, but most of the time, not so much. With so many big questions stemming from my central quandary, I dived into trying to understand what happens when we constantly keep our brains busy and never give ourselves time to mentally meander. I spoke with neuroscientists and cognitive psychologists about mind wandering, what our brains do when we're doing nothing at all, or not fully focused on a task. We may feel like we're doing very little when we endlessly fold laundry, but our brains are actually hard at work. When our minds wander, we activate something called the default mode, the mental place where we solve problems and generate our best ideas and engage in what's known as autobiographical planning, which is how we make sense of the world and our lives and set future goals. The default mode is also involved in how we try to understand and empathize with other people and make moral judgments. When we let ourselves space out and our minds wander, we do our most original thinking and problem solving. Without distraction, your mind can go to some interesting and unexpected places. Creativity, no matter how you define or apply it, needs a push. And boredom, which allows new and different connections to form in our brain, is a most effective muse. It's what the futurist Rita King calls, quote, the tedium of creativity. For King, someone whose job it is to conceive of anything from how a town might look 200 years from now to actions business leaders should embark on to take advantage of trends coming down the line, creativity is her business. The mistake a lot of people make is to assume the euphoria of an idea is going to persist all the way through the countless little steps that need to happen before the idea becomes real, she says. Many lose heart or momentum because those little tiny things that have to get done are so dull. The tedium of creativity can be daunting, King explains, especially when compared to the satisfaction of crossing things off a to-do list, which explains why I make my to-do list so long. But if we let it, inspiration can strike if we give ourselves permission to take time to focus on nothing in particular before drifting off to sleep, in the shower, while taking a walk in the woods. The default mode is not surprisingly also called the imagination network. Being bored gives us the space to ask, what if? That's an essential question regarding not only any creative endeavor, but also our emotional health and personal growth. According to Dr. Jonathan Smallwood, professor of cognitive neuroscience and an expert in mind wandering at the University of York, in a very deep way, there's a close link between originality and creativity and the spontaneous thoughts we generate when our minds are idle. In other words, you have to let yourself be bored to be brilliant. So I wanted to know, if we changed our relationship to our gadgets, could we generate bigger and better ideas? Would there be a ripple effect of changes to the way that we work, the way we parent, the way we relate to one another? Could this change the way we see the world? Suspecting note to self listeners would want to know as well, in February 2015, my team and I created the Bored and Brilliant Project to investigate and test my theory. We developed a week-long series of challenges designed to help people detach from their devices and jumpstart their creativity. I heard a lot of listeners and people around me grumbling that everyone these days is always looking at their phone. But I wasn't sure if rethinking our relationship to smartphones, laptops, and tablets would spark a lot of enthusiasm from the public. My bosses at WNYC, however, told me to trust my instincts. So I put aside my doubts and asked others to join me in reclaiming time to space out. And listeners of all ages vigorously nodded yes. They showed their support with tweets and emails and Facebook posts. Yeah, ironic, I know. and most important, by signing up for the project. In the end, more than 20,000 people signed on to the Bored and Brilliant project from just about every state. The highest concentrations of participants were from New York City, San Francisco, LA, DC, Chicago, and out of the blue, Arkansas. We also had participants from Slovakia, Israel, Denmark, Australia, and the UK. This was something a lot of people had been thinking about, even though the problem hadn't yet been named. Before we began, we surveyed the participants on their motivations, desires, and dreams for this experiment. From the answers we received, a few clear trends and themes emerged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.